Hi everyone, my name is Bob Greenier and I am a volunteer with the Martin Fleischmann Memorial Project. Okay, so before I get into the meat of this presentation today, I just want to say a few thank yous and I really want to extend a real gratitude to the University of Aarhus and particularly the chemistry department where I've been over the last 6 weeks off and on for short periods of time. Particularly I wanted to thank the courage of Kim for both inviting me and to listen to what I had to say, and also for his family for welcoming me and helping me live a little in the city of Aarhus. I also want to extend my gratitude to Alina for adding a little levity whilst I was there, and also to Matteo for accommodating me when I couldn't find anywhere to sleep. So thank you very much, guys. So I learned quite a few things whilst I was at Aarhus, and one of those things, it was like a revelation. Essentially, there's these postdocs and master's students, and they're doing some really great research there, and they've got these lovely chemistry labs, and they're in and out and so forth. But you know what I noticed is, just like when I was doing chemistry at higher education, I never really did anything that got really hot. And it occurred to me when I was looking at one of the fume hoods that it had like a polymer base, and I'm thinking, oh, okay, yeah, the fume hood's great, but if we're gonna run something really hot in here, we're gonna have to think about, you know, maybe protecting that. And then I'm thinking, well, okay, most of the chemistry that's done, I mean, that's always done, it's kind of done in like glass, like this borosilicate glass here, you know, or Pyrex. And often, even if you have a Bunsen burner or a gas flame or whatever, heating that, or whatever else that's heating it, there's a fluid in there that means that it doesn't get beyond its sort of softening point, which may be 300 degrees or upwards. And, you know, really, I don't think I can ever recall seeing much chemistry done, you know, at 800 degrees, because it becomes really difficult to contain things at that temperature. So that's kind of like one area of experimentation. And then I had the real pleasure of going over to their physics department. And they showed me their accelerator. And we had a few discussions. And well, to cut a long story short, their accelerator goes down to, it starts from, that is, 200 kilo electron volts. So, you know, if you go and look this up, you'll see that 200 kilo electron volts is like, I don't know, millions of degrees. And then you've got the chemistry department across the road, and it's kind of like not really going much higher than, you know, in the hundreds of degrees, okay? Maybe the over 700 degrees or something. And there's real reasons for that, because if you want to develop industrial processes, you're kind of looking at doing catalysis to keep things at low temperatures so that when you actually do a process, it's efficient and it can be made commercial. And of course, the nuclear scientists, well, they've got to bash things together, haven't they? So they need really high energies. But think about it for a minute. You know, a little earlier in the year, I discussed a New Scientist article, and this, I think it was this year or last year, anyway, it was before now, and that was talking about the fact that in all of the history of man, we've only really scraped the surface of chemistry, just chemistry. Like 1% of chemistry has been explored, let's say, and this is what this article was saying. And the reason is that most chemistry in the universe goes on inside planets. It goes in on gigapascals of pressure and high temperatures, you know, in suns and stuff. The chemistry is, the bulk of the chemistry in the universe is not done in a conical flask on a Bunsen burner, yeah? And then you've got the nuclear physicists over there, and they're incredible energies. But you know what? There's this whole ocean of temperatures that no one really has been exploring. You know, I mean, maybe they have, but you know, for the most part, they're dealing in these two separate universes. And of course, that's because one's like dealing with electrons and the other one's dealing with the super energy of the binding force of the nucleus. That's the thinking, isn't it? But it's kind of like saying, you know, I live in America and I'm in the chemistry lab over here in New York and it's really cool and hip and we're doing lots of excellent stuff. And now we're going to go over to California. And, you know, it's a bigger universe and there's lots more that can happen. But, you know, it's you know, there's a bit in the middle, but that's just the flyover states, right? Nothing happens there. Well, I can tell you a lot happens there because I went to Minnesota to join HUG to do some experiments there. Some really great guys there. And I also went to University of Missouri. And they are doing LENA research there and have been for more than half a decade, I think, now. And there's some really intelligent people doing research at that university. So they're in the flyover states, okay? So it's maybe not the greatest analogy, but it leads me on to my next point. I had the pleasure of meeting and having an evening with and watching a lecture of a world-leading chemist called Christian Amateur. He's a Frenchman. You can look him up, he's absolutely fantastic. He doesn't really have great opinions on this space, but that's understandable. You know, I'm a skeptic too, but I'm trying. And two things I learned from him, which may be profoundly important here, and it's not what I'm kind of come into, but it's going to play into that. He deals in catalytic chemistry and trying to explain it on another level. And he talks about these things called transition states. And he described this process, and I'm going to do a kind of like a similar description of it. He says that, you know, there's a point over here that you observe, which is the chemical compounds you start with, and then there is a point over here which you can observe, which is the chemical compounds or products of the reaction, and it's what exactly goes on in between. Because it can happen so very, very quickly, even in chemistry, but you know, in nuclear physics, it can happen in femtoseconds. What is the actual thing that happens between point A and point B? And so he described it like this. He said that, like, imagine an archer, and let's take it, this Frenchman, he's over here, he's got his bow, and he's pulling it back like this, he's got his arrow in the bow, and he's lifting it up like that, and he lets go, and over here, there's some dappy English king, and it goes, gets in his eye and he dies, right? So over here, the guy with the bow's lost an arrow, and the guy over here has gained one. And those are the two states. And he said, you don't see the arrow in the air because it goes too fast to observe it. But it still happens. And so transition states are things that are not really easy to understand. Well, maybe it is for Christian Amateur, but you know, it's just something I came across. He said something else in his lecture, actually. This was the night before, but in his lecture, he was going about catalytic processes, and he was saying that, you know, if you start off with your catalysis, blah, 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 happens, some reactions happen, but really to get back into the point where the catalyst is in its original state, you can't just do that thermally. Now, maybe I misread this and people can check the facts, but this is what I got from his lecture, that you can't just do it thermally. You need to either give it electricity, electrochemistry, or you need to kind of hit it with light. And this kind of resets the chemistry. And that gets me thinking, you know, maybe at high temperatures when we've got photons in the visible range, can that reset the catalyst? Okay, so. With those concepts in mind, and the thank yous behind me for where I'm going with this, I would like to talk to you about something that was I was made aware of by a crowd researcher, or just a crowd participant who's interested in our project. And thank you very, very much. I'll tell you who that was at the end. Anyway, I call this presentation Doppelgänger. And I'm going to start by asking you a question. What if you had a document that, well, actually it's multiple questions. What if you had a document that showed nuclear synthesis without harmful radiation? Had two catalysts, a big one and a small one, could self-sustain, operated between 300 and 1500 degrees C and above, had demonstrated meltdowns, worked as a fluid, could be enhanced by other catalysts, and potentially gave insight to the whole LENA field. What would you say? You'd say, gimme, gimme, gimme. Yeah, okay, well, this guy, he found this patent. Well, it's an application, and he made us aware of it. But before we come on to that, I just want to talk about this very famous table here from the Lugano ash. And this is a reactor that was run in Lugano in southern Switzerland, and some university professors from Uppsala and Bologna, they conducted an experiment, and following the experiment, they analyzed the ash with a whole range, and the fuel in the ash, with a whole range of analysis techniques, and they basically came up with, you get more lithium-6 at the end ratio over lithium-7 than you start with. And most of the nickel becomes, apparently, nickel 62. This is probably the most important result of that experiment, and it's the most contested point about that experiment. So major shifts in both nickel and lithium isotopes. Now, the people that know about this will have heard about this before. Let's move on. So, what is the main energy coming from? You know, where is the main energy coming from? Well, the scientists at Uppsala University, who actually did some of the analysis on the ash, they kind of favor this neutron stripping reaction, where the 7 lithium in some sort of connection to the nickel loses its neutron, gives it over to the nickel, and becomes 6 lithium. And ostensibly, this kind of like, it basically explains the observed phenomena. And Carl Oscar Goldstrom, I think he's called, he has a theory, a bound neutron theory, to explain this. Anyway, so that's one theory. And then there's another theory here, which is fusion fission decay. Proton goes into 7 lithium, becomes 8 beryllium, and that goes down to 2-4 helium. And this is the first time that the atom was split, it was kind of fusion split. And that was done by Cockcroft and Walton in 1932, and they won the Nobel Prize for this. And that was because they proved that Einstein was correct in that it was possible to split the atom and that there would be bagloads of energy coming from that. It's favored by Pintelli, and it gives a yield of around 17 mega electron volts. Moving on. So, Paynton, US application 0263758A1. Look it up. There'll be a link to this patent in this PDF, which will be accessible from the YouTube video. So, a process is disclosed for the generation of energy achieved when an ionic hydride or deuteride is heated with certain elements capable of forming a covalent hydride or deuteride, respectively. I mean, that's basically the headline here. Kind of sounds familiar, doesn't it? So credit goes to Richard A. Day, Kenneth A. Rubison, Terence McConville, and Alfred Cornell. Big up, guys. Priority date, May the 3rd, 2006. 2006, okay? Published November the 15th, 2007. Okay? Rossi gave his first public demonstration on January the 14th, 2011. Okay, this is over 3 years later. Now, what I really want is for there to be, this is a moment for the science, it's the time has come. It's a singularity. I would like Rossi to have independently done this. The reason being that he will have found the same process essentially as claimed by these four claimants in this patent application. He will have effectively been a replicator, but he has taken it a little bit further, obviously. He's would apparently have commercialized the energy levels. But for me, I really, really hope that it wasn't a case of we found this patent and made it useful. I really hope for Rossi that this was, I independently discovered something extremely similar. Fantastic. Moving on. So, what is it about? Well, excess heat from Lena and something like lithium and a lithium aluminium hydride would qualify in this patent. And as you will see, it is a good choice relatively from a safety standpoint. So this patent covers just an excess heat process coming from just lithium and lithium aluminium hydride. Why? Because the lithium can form Li plus H minus, that's an ionic hydride. And the lithium aluminium hydride can form a covalent hydride. That's where you've got the H and the four hydrogens, and that becomes the valency for the lithium. So that qualifies for this patent's overall abstract. The patent's preferred embodiment is to use antimony. Here it is, Sb antimony, which forms stibine with a protium, which is gas, which is phenomenally toxic, okay? I think it's something like 50 parts per million will kill you in a very short space of time. Bear that in mind, okay? This is why this probably was a good choice to go down the lithium aluminium hydride route. So, but it has a short bond length, so like 1.707 angstroms. And angles, this diddy bitty angle here, 91.7, which can be excited into vibrational modes by terahertz radiation, read IR. The hydrogen could be replaced by deuterium. And you know, maybe that'll have some change on the bond lengths and so on, and the angles. But here's the thing, what do I mean by vibrational modes? Well, imagine I've got two bonds here, they're two arms, yeah? And, you know, if I'm getting some excitation, I can move my atoms in. You know, you can do it like that, or maybe like that. Or you can do it like this. Or you can do it like that. So that, I can only do two, because I'd like three arms, but I've only got two. Okay, so that you can move that around with terahertz radiation. So this is like kind of like the average state. This is what I understand. You know, I don't care if I'm wrong, I only care if I'm right. Please, if you know better, let's make this better. This information needs to be clean. So into the mix, you place molten ionic hydride, like lithium plus H minus or sodium plus D minus, okay, into the mix. The H minus and D minus causes a collapse of the hydrogen isotopes on the main catalyst, and via transition state, listen to that, there is a collective condensation leading to nuclear synthesis. So you've got these bonds here, they're like this. I'm gonna do it over here on the camera over here, but they're like this, right? And so, and your H minus comes in like that, maybe into here somewhere, and it's like Piantelli says, it's a proton with two electrons, it's a fermion, and the patent claims that it replaces one of these hydrogen or deuteriums, depending on what isotopes you're using, and that just pulls the whole thing together until you get some form of condensation, nuclear reorganization, and so it's catalyzing it. And it's saying that you increase the tunneling chances by having the distances between 0.5 and 2 angstroms, okay? Now the distance here between the antimony and the hydrogen is 1.707 angstroms, but you know, there will be some spread here, so the actual distance between the two hydrogen might be over 2 angstroms, but it's still a lot closer than a hydrogen over here and a hydrogen over here, isn't it, a hydrogen atom, yeah? It's bringing them down to catalytic scales, yeah? Moving on. So, as an aside, we had some pressure drops in 5.3. They were large, reversible pressure drops at a kind of a small temperature range, kind of in the mid-range between sort of 500 or 400 and 900, something around there. This needs to be cleared up. Echo, if you're listening, let's see if we can pinpoint that by going back into the data. And it was basically quite a lot higher either side of this temperature zone. Now, could that have been lithium 3 aluminium H6 and 2 1H minus in an unstable intermediate state? So you got two of these kind of in the molecule, and one's coming in, and it's not got to the point of condensating that matter, but it's kind of like more than liquid kind of like density of protons. Okay, so there are various different options here. So if you've got normal lithium aluminium hydride, you've got a bond distance of between 1.59 and 1.64 angstroms. Yeah? For lithium 3 aluminium H6, it's 1.72 angstroms for the bond length, but something's happened here, and it's kind of like brought the angles closer together. And I'm just gonna go over to this camera over here and try and describe this. So we had the antimony on the previous presentation, and we might like to say that the antimony looks a bit like this. So there's the antimony, and here is our ALH4. This is what bonds with each of the lithium ions in the covalent ionic hydride. Covalent hydride, rather. And so you can see that kind of like the distance overall is a bit bigger, right? But if we want to go from the ALH4 to the phase which is ALH6, I'm going to do this. I'm going to move this over here. And it's not quite like this because it's just because of these models. And thank you to the chemistry department for letting me, let's say, borrow these. There we go. So it's a bit like the antimony now. So the overall distances are actually less, even though the bond length, it may be less. Because remember, these bonds are able to go in and out and side to side in the whole combination. And this allows your H minus to come in here, or your D minus, and if these are all Ds, deuterides, come in, and it's kind of like in a much better position to get in there and start condensing this matter. So, there we go. For this camera, there we go. This is the ALH6, something like this, okay. So in this instance, it's 1.72 angstroms. So ostensibly it's bigger, and we'll come on to what we can do about that later. But LIL3, ALH6. Now, note these can be highly toxic, right? So, stibine, 1.707, we saw that on the previous slide. Angle, 91.7. Arsine, that's above stibine in the same group in the periodic table. Arsenic with hydrogen. This is antimony with hydrogen. This is even more toxic than this. I think this is like 25 parts per million. It will kill you in about half an hour. So you need to seriously think about conducting these experiments. It's not a joke. Okay? 1.519 angstroms, very much significantly less. Yeah? And it's only a squidgen bigger. 91.7 here, 91.8 here. Now, like I say, you can download the PDF and you can have a real close look at these things. And there'll be links everywhere. And here's a germanium, and that's kind of a bit like our aluminium hydride, but it's 1.525 angstroms, the bond length here, okay? Now, I'm gonna move on. The 6-lithium-7-lithium ratio increase in Lugano. In respect of deuterium, this is what's in this patent application. In respect of deuterium and catalysts such as antimony, the patent claims with 3 deuteriums, 6 lithium is the predominant product. So it's synthesizing 6 lithium. We're not having a strip of a neutron from 7 lithium, yeah? It isn't disappearing because the proton's hitting the 7 lithium and you're getting 2,4-helium. You're making 6 lithium. Or maybe you're not. Because if it was using lithium aluminium deuteride, then 6 lithium could be synthesized. But however, on page 28 of the Lugano report, it says the fuel did not contain deuterium. And that's the quote there. And you can go and have a look at that. So let's accept that the fact that they're using lithium aluminium hydride. Okay? So what you want to do is, we've identified that it might be more favorable to be a lithium 3 aluminium hydride 6, where any group of the 3, protium and 1 protide H minus leads to 4H, that's quadrium, which decays to tritium plus a neutron. Could this explain neutrons observed in the glow stick 5.3? Maybe, I don't know. Neutrons could transmute nickel isotopes as other cells and other cell constituents, yielding a range of elements and potential secondary reaction products. It's kind of what other claimants are saying might happen. Neutrons could transmute 7-lithium to 8-lithium, and 8-lithium decays to 2 alphas and a beta, and it's a stupidly energetic beta, whose high energy would be dissipated as Cherenkov radiation. Could this explain signal? I mean, we had lithium aluminium hydride, but it's impossible that some of that, for that lithium aluminium hydride to not have some deuterons in them. So could we have just got to the very sweet spot that a number of deuterons in the right conditions with another deuteron in place, just a statistical, ridiculously small chance, but it was the right moment for all of them that to stick up their hands and make 8-lithium, which in a fraction of a second decays and gives a huge beta burst. Is that it? Was that what signal was? Was it something similar when we injected fresh hydrogen into a Chalani cell in 2013? Was it just the deuterium contents that was able to replace or exchange with some of the protium on the highly loaded constant and treated wire? And just for that moment in time, do this reaction. Was it that? I don't know. We need to run a lot more experiments. Would it explain the blue glow in the claimed ECAD-X? I mean, ECAD-X might be lithium aluminium deuteride with, I don't know, germanium or platinum or combination of these materials. And it doesn't need a lot of drive, as you'll find out, according to the claims of this patent. And it's producing lots and lots of beta, which is creating Cherenkov radiation. And basically, Cherenkov radiation is like when an F-16 goes through the speed of sound, you know, it's going faster than the sound wave, so it kind of has this propagation out of, it's similar to that, but it's with light. You've got light going through a dielectric medium, charged particle going through a dielectric medium, and it has this shock wave that it's sending out, and this creates this blue glow. Okay. So, however, the patent, this patent says no 3-hydrogen, that's tritium, is observed. Okay, all right. We're gonna stop and start and go to the next slide. Why no 3-hydrogen? Why no tritium? So, is 4-hydrogen, that's quadrium, becoming 4-helium? Ah, no, this doesn't happen. Well, yes, it does. It happens in suns. The sun loses energy. Okay, so there's a link to this paper. You can find it here, okay? It's some doctorate thesis. The sun loses energy by radiation, but remains stable due to the production of energy by hydrogen burning. The main burning cycle in the sun is called the PP cycle, where hydrogen is fused to helium. The net reaction can be written as quadrium plus 2 electrons goes to helium plus some neutrinos and a bucket load of energy. That's 26.73 MeV. I haven't been able to study this enough to know whether that actually is attached to the helium. And let's assume that maybe some of it is. That's really, really important. But anyway, so that would be in our stibine molecule or our arsine or in our aluminium H6 molecule. Like you've got something here. And you've got the deuteron coming in, and it's making, or this is for 4 protons, so this is using lithium aluminium hydride. You've got proton, proton, proton. You've got protide coming in. It causes a collapse, a condensation. What have you got? Well, you've got 1H, 2H, 3H, with the electron shared with the antimony, okay? And you've got protide coming in, another proton with 2 electrons, right? And a collapse. So you've got proton, 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 proton. And in this one, you've got 2 electrons. 4 protons, 2 electrons. Oh my. Exactly as claimed in the patent. And one might ask if it can provide an alternative explanation for the observations of Cannon, Piantelli, Rossi, Brillouin, Clean Planet, or just most of them. And with deuterium, Pons, and Fleischmann. But of course, in these more solid state systems, non-liquid, not catalyzed in the same way systems, or maybe they are by impurities, you're getting a system where you have to load that transition metal as far as it would go after you've got rid of everything else, and particularly oxygen. so that then it's completely loaded and you've got all of these hydrogens all over the surface, in the cracks, Edmund storms, on the ovoid shaped and in the cracks with the ovoids and the kind of fractal ovoids that you would get with Clean Planet and Mizuno's work with the in situ preparation of their material. So it's absolutely really dense. And then you hit it with a shock, or you get the H minus coming in. So you create through plasma discharge in cannon various radical species, or plasma through the dielectric barrier discharge, like in the newly placed German application, patent application, or in the Clean Planet and Cannon patent. The Clean Planet patent, where it's discharging straight into the material. So you are creating H minus in situ, and this might even be because you've got low work function material like calcium oxide in there doping your hydrogen storage member, and this is giving up electrons quite readily to create the H minus to allow this type of condensation occurring on the surface. So it isn't, as Piantelli says, if we assume that this is right, it isn't as Piantelli says that, you know, it's going into the nucleus of the transition metal. And, you know, when you speak to a physicist about this, they'll just go, well, that's bonkers. And it doesn't matter if the key element as defined and hypothesized by Thomas Graham FRS in 1867 is H minus, and that allows for this higher than liquid density to occur in, say, for instance, palladium with deuterium. Of course, he didn't have deuterium back then because it wasn't discovered until early 30s. Anyway, so the point is, you can get this condensation of matter, but it's really difficult. It's really difficult to do this, and everyone knows it's really difficult. Is this the answer? I don't know. But I want you to go out there, and if you are qualified, and you really know what you're doing, and you are aware of all of the risks, and you know how to take the precautions necessary, there may be a real opportunity to crack this nut. Moving on. So, let's say we've got these stupidly energetic alpha 4 helium atoms. If the 4 helium was going to be transmuting nickel, you would get 58 to 62 nickel by way of positron emitting 62 nickel and 62 copper, 60 nickel to 65 copper stable, 61 nickel to 65, to 5 copper by way of short-lived positron emitting 65 zinc, 62 nickel to so on, and basically the kind of things you observe. And if you're only looking at the nickel, then the 62 nickel would be the predominant isotope in the ash, because let's face it, you've got 58 going to 62, and essentially there's a lot of 58. So if everything moves over to copper and zinc, you're going to end up with mostly, you know, by the time the fuel's used and there's no more 4 helium being created, you're going to end up with mostly 62 nickel in the ash, right? However, on page 29 of the Lagana report, the authors say that stable zinc is not found in the ash, which is unsurprising, because basically it's really difficult to get helium to go into nickel. It's really difficult. But is it impossible? The stupid energies that this helium might be? I don't know. Maybe in the straight lithium aluminium hydride and lithium and nickel system, maybe it is difficult for this to occur. But when you're creating those 8 lithiums and that's decaying, as I saw, when you're creating these quadriums and that's decaying and you've got these very, very high energy helium, maybe it's possible. I don't know. I still think it's fairly unlikely. Okay. But I'm no expert. So please, experts, plenty of criticism, please. How can the aluminium disappear? Well, maybe it's a little easier for the helium to change the alpha. This one's a bit hard, but 30 silicon plus proton? Hello. Okay, so the helium might make the aluminium all into 30 silicon. I mean, certainly there seems to be evidence that silicon's in the ash. And that's making proton. I don't know what the energy of that proton is, by the way. But anyway, protons from R2 could interact with nickel to result in the observed ash transmutations. And they could also interact with 7 lithium to change that ratio, the 6 lithium over 7 lithium ratio. So maybe something's going on here. So this patent application actually isn't just we think this happens. There is evidence that they actually did these experiments, or certainly tables that claim that they did them. And they're saying for various embodiments here, using a number of procedures, they got from this is sodium, deuterium, and antimony. They got 21 nanogram atoms, I think that's what this is, and that would give a theoretical joules of 50,700, and they observed in their calorimeter 57,300. So there's something else going on in there, maybe, you know, or it's just inaccuracy in the calorimeter, but it's pretty close. In their second procedure, and it's all defined in the patent application, they got 36 nanograms of atoms, 86,400 joules of energy from the 3D to 6Li synthesis, and the observed joules was 93. Again, it's more, so maybe there is something a little bit extra going on. But listen to what you're looking at here. It's sodium, deuterium, and antimony. There's no lithium. So if lithium's in the ash like they observed, it's a slam dunk. Boom! Yeah? Table 2, protium deuterium conversion to 3 helium and 4 helium with boron and germanium catalysts. So they've got a whole bunch of stuff here. If you use boron, you get some lithium. And if you start with sodium and germanium, you get helium and 4 heliums and 3 heliums. I mean, great. It'd be really nice to have a system to create 3 heliums. There isn't a lot of them about. Okay, so, I'm just going to read you this quote. This is from the patent application. No high energy radiation escapes the hermetically sealed cell during heat production with deuterium fusion, nor is any detectable amount of radioactive product produced when the cell's contents are examined. Maybe I've heard that before somewhere. Anyway, it's in this patent application. Lack of radiation. Meltdowns. When germanium is used, and remember from our table way back when, germanium has the really short bond lengths, yeah? When germanium is used as a catalyst, temperatures rapidly rise above the melting point of stainless steel, 1450 degrees C. Thus, with germanium, reaction vessels need to be made of higher melting alloys to avoid container failure. That sounds a bit like a nuclear process to me. Yeah? And these, as I said at the beginning, these aren't experiments that they're doing in the chemistry department, and they're certainly not experiments they're doing in the physics department. It's in this big blue ocean of opportunity. Self-sustain. By the way, these are the actual paragraph numbers in the patent, so just convenient for you. If the cell and its contents are heated while maintaining elevated pressure, the reaction will be self-sustaining. This is a pretty bold claim here. Will be self-sustaining. It's not like, oh, we might get it once in a blue moon, or we have to do something really difficult to achieve it. Essentially, the reaction can then be controlled by use of heat exchangers, which will maintain the temperature at acceptable levels. Generally below 1500 degrees C, because it's difficult to get material that works comfortably for long periods of time above that. And above 900 to 1000 degrees C, the kind of temperatures these ionic hydrides kind of give up their H minus or D minus. Yeah, this kind of 850, 900, like we're finding with the lithium hydride. Thus, the reaction will be self-sustaining and heat can be removed that can be used as an energy source. So there is a domain. And as long as you keep the reactor within this scope of, say, 900 or 1,000, depending on your catalyst, and 1,500 degrees C. If you stay in that zone, it will self-sustain as long as you do not extract too much heat, but you need to have extract enough heat so that it doesn't melt down, or, and it specifies this very clearly, for some embodiments, the covalent hydride breaks down and the reaction ceases. So you know, if it's a reaction that will fail before 1500 degrees with a particular catalyst, dual catalyst combination and hydrogen isotope that you use, then you will be able to have a fail-safe system. And this needs a little bit of heuristic research, but if you think it's relevant to think about the bond lengths, the terahertz radiation excitation of those bonds, you know, whatever they're doing, yeah? All of these different things, you can narrow down the parameter space. Adding heat, great suggestion, you know? Alternatively, at lower temperatures, this is another quote, paragraph 35, where the reaction is not self-sustaining, i.e. below 900 degrees C, and above 300 degrees C, a non-self-sustaining reaction will occur. Thus, the reaction chamber, essentially what it's saying is you can place the reaction chamber like, I don't know, in a solar thermal collector, you know, and you just have the molten salts going through that are warmed up by the solar thermal, and the molten salts are going over this reactor, and it's like tripling the energy yield from your solar thermal collector. Or you put it in, I don't know, you modify it so that it goes into the air intake or some sort of gases in a jet turbine, and it just increases the heat and the thrust because it's more energetic. Or you put it in your gas or coal or even nuclear, old nuclear, really old nuclear power station to bump up the energy output from your primary source of heat. Well, this actually might be the primary source of heat. You're just using the primary source of heat to trigger this reaction. So, you know, you can drive this with gas, right? I seem to recall someone else saying that, you know, you can get the reaction to work just by using gas. You don't need electricity. There was a lot of skepticism about that, but here it is, in a patent application whose priority is 2006. Transition metal. Okay, listen, at first glance, there appears to be no transition metal in this system. However, all suggested reactor embodiments contain transition metals. So maybe they didn't get a great yield because it does need that secondary or tertiary catalytic effect to make it really go. Testing a suggested embodiment in an aluminium oxide, like a glow stick or similar, would resolve this. But you know what? If it does work in aluminium oxide, boom! You don't need transition metals. It's really going to tell us whether this is the process going on, yeah? Fuel ratios. Okay, I'm getting down to the meat here with what you actually need to do. Procedure one, remember there was the two procedures in the earlier part of this presentation that yielded different numbers of nanograms of lithium. The molar ratio of hydride deuteride salt, that's like, I don't know, sodium deuteride, to catalyst, like antimony, so you get some powdered antimony and some sodium deuteride. Put them together, you should have 10 times the sodium deuteride to 1 times the antimony. There you go, bang, it's already done for you. Just try it, yeah? But play safe. This ostensibly is a nuclear synthesis process. Procedure 2.27. Paragraph 27, the molar ratio of catalytic elements, such as antimony, these square brackets are mine for clarity, to reactive metal, preferred metal is sodium, there's other metals you can use, to hydrogen deuterium should be catalyst, 0.01 of a mole, reactive metal, 0.1 of a mole, hydrogen deuterium, 0.001 to 0.002 mole. Really? Not a lot of moles, really small amounts of moles. You need picograms. So, You see my Lena Live Proposal 1. You've seen my Lena Live Proposal 2. This is Lena Live Proposal 3. And maybe someone can do it during ICCF 20, you know? The gauntlet is officially slapped down on the floor. Go for meltdown. Now, I want you to all pay attention. Proceed with extreme caution. Only consider this if you are competent, have remotely controlled lab, and taken all necessary safety precautions. Do not attempt this unless you believe you meet these criteria. Germanium, sodium hydride, and hydrogen. Expect 4 helium and 3 helium. With a residual gas analyzer, boom! Synthesis proven. Germanium and sodium deuteride and deuterium. Expect 4 helium and 3 helium and some lithium. Boom! Synthesis proven. Show what a steel reactor does at maximum power of heater. Yeah, so we got a steel reactor, we put it into our looking for heat, let's say, Model T, put it in there, see what it does when you heat it up. Show what the steel does with the fuel in the maximum power of heater. Yeah, so one's got the fuel, one hasn't got the fuel. You can do it in separate runs. Yeah. You want a really conclusive test? I mean, conclusive? Reactants such as sodium and sodium deuteride and antimony, or maybe as indicated in the table and patent, you can have a look at what's really required. You slowly rise that to 950 to 1050 degrees C. So we're finding you need to slowly raise and adjust the temperature up and down a little bit to get this these kind of systems to work. But within these temperature range, this system will not work outside this temperature range. Yeah. So if you go above 1050, the stibine, the antimony 3 hydride, will break down, reaction stops. Okay, so it's a nice, safer one. So you raise this over 2 to 12 hours. Yeah, kind of, this is a bit Parkhamov, isn't it? That's interesting, isn't it? Anyway, then hold this range for as long as you can convenient to ensure maximum synthesis. So, you know, if you've got a week, or a month, or, you know, more than a month, hold it. And then the ash should contain 6 lithium that's not present in the fuel. As per this table, boom, proven. So what makes this really special? Really special. It is a liquid, double catalytic chemical system with simple preparation. It's driven only by heat, so you can heat it with gas. You can heat it with a solar reflector. You can heat it with, electrical heater. It's controllable by simple heat extraction, you know. If you stay in that sweet spot, you can control it. If you keep it below the sort of self-sustain range, like where it's kind of running away with itself, it can just add heat. If you're in the self-sustain range, as long as you keep it under the sort of like breakdown of your reactor, the patent is claiming you can keep this self-sustaining. Can fail safe when the covalent hydride breaks down. So, there you go. It requires no specially constructed nanoparticles or complicated electronics. You don't need a special type of stimulation, you don't need, but these things might help. And listen to what I said right way back from Christian Amateur. He says, on this catalytic cycle, you can't get back to, and this is what I understand, sorry Christian if I'm wrong, but you can't get back to the origination position unless you stimulate with electrons or light. But here's the beauty. When you get over that 900 degrees, you get from terahertz and thermal radiation into the visible spectrum. So if you've got nanostructures might be useful. Maybe that's why we need these nanoparticles and nanostructures on our tertiary catalyst. You can get plasmons, and maybe this is creating the kind of reset to the catalyst. It may give insight into how all Lena works. Yeah? I kind of touched on this a little bit earlier, but think about it. Is this really what we've been looking at all this time? It will be free to deploy from May the 3rd, 2026. And not a moment too soon. Yes, folks, in 2026, May the 3rd, this patent runs out. Woohoo! So, I want to say thank you. I want to bring your attention to this reactor that I designed earlier in the year. I will publish the design for this. This is, I think, a $3 or a $6, maybe no more than $11 high temperature. I think it goes up to 1,200 immersion heater ceramic, like sealed unit. You can get on Alibaba. And it goes into this, which you would make out of a fully cused, as in fully homogeneously direct laser metal sintering process. This is an additive manufacturer. It's in two parts, and you can just build it on the same bed, many reactors at the same time, and you just put this $11 max heater into it, and away you go. You brush your material in here. If you want a separate hydrogen source, you just tip it into one of the little trays. Yeah? Okay. Here's another simple one. This is made out of a billet, 10 centimeters. This is the kind of thing that I would see going into like the looking for heat or any type of other furnace. You know, you could put this kind of thing into just a furnace. You know, run 20 different reactors in there with this is for your thermal well here. So what you've got here is this is made from a billet of material and this is made from a billet. And you could CNC this. And essentially, this is you put this on the lathe and you lathe this out. You drill a hole, maybe in the lathe with a drill bit. And this is again, you can lathe this and drill that out. And it comes together and you weld around this seam, then you pour your fuel in there, you pack it down as you push this in, and then you weld around this seam and this seam. And when you're testing your reactor, this is a thermal well, and when you finish testing your reactor and you want to make this cartridge concept a reactor you can use, you can then put a cartridge heater, these standard type of 4mm cartridge heaters, into there, and away you go, you've got your product. So, I want to thank James Stevenson for making me aware of this patent. Thank you, James. You showed, like so many others have done over the more than 4 years of the Martin Fleischmann Memorial Project, how important it is to share what you know, even if you don't fully understand it. Now, I don't fully understand it. But there's so much meat in this patent application and the implications of it that there are real actionable things that people can do to test the claims that are there. I'd like to thank the patent authors themselves for their groundbreaking research. And I'd like to thank all of the MFMP donors for making this research possible. What is the role of nickel? Okay, so I thought there might be this tertiary catalyst role. There's a great piece of research. I've got a link here. What we found in the Bang experiment is it would appear that the lithium aluminium liquid that was wetted or seemed to be wetted to the surface of the sintered nickel mesh had some nickel about 3-4% in it. I think it was 3-4%. Anyway, you can check our site. Anyway, so basically, nickel, firstly, is known to accelerate the low temperature breakdown of lithium aluminium hydride. Molten lithium and or lithium aluminium can part dissolve the nickel. Now, this paper shows some aluminium atoms here and some nickel in this nanocluster. And maybe it is that you need the aluminium to get in there and break off something from the AH50 or the Parkamov nickel to make a little nanocluster. Then the lithium hydride formation forces the creation of the nickel hydride nanoparticles. So you have the lithium in there, but then hydrogen's being released from the lithium aluminium hydride, and that forces that changes the molten lithium to lithium hydride, which then is basically solid, and it has to lose its kind of dissolved nickel status, and it creates this precipitate of nickel nanoclusters. And what happens is, according to this paper, is the aluminium hydride itself, ALH4, or whatever form the aluminium hydride is in, it may be other phases, but they're saying ALH4, this stabilizes nickel nanoparticles at 2 to 3 nanometers. You know, maybe this is really good for taking that post-infrared, that kind of visible light, and resetting the catalysts, yeah? This requires a slow temperature rise. To do all this requires you to go slow, okay? And there's the surface plasmon comment. I've got another bonus for you. Shock waves in condensed matter. Shock waves are used to achieve high pressures and densities in condensed matter, okay? Then, so this is like your, I don't know, your Brillouin reactor, yeah? Sending a really, really high current pulse. Bang! That's a shock wave going through this highly loaded material. And because the shock compression is thermodynamically irreversible, it is accompanied by an increase in temperature. For example, water shocked to 30 gigapascals is compressed more than twofold in density and heated to 2000 K. Wow. So hit it with a hammer. You know, there is research out there where they took Soviet submarine panels, loaded it with deuterium, and smacked it with a hammer, and you got neutrons, yeah? It's like a shock, and this is what Piantelli says. Just shock it with anything, anything. Just electrical shock, sonic shock, pressure shock, anything. Give it a shock. Anyway, you can read that. There's the source. So shock in lithium aluminium hydride specifically, right? There's some research out there, and basically they're saying that if you get to 2.6 gigapascals, there's a phase change. And you can get a really serious reduction. So earlier on I showed you that it's 1.59 to 1.6 angstroms, the distance in this tetrahedral hydride, yeah? And this is within that 0.5 to 2 that would maybe give you a better chance of tunneling and fusion synthesis through that. But apparently if you shock it, right, you can get the four hydrogens, because it maybe changes phase to the AlH6, and you can get from here to 1.23 and 1.36 angstroms. Now, I want people to dig into this paper, because I've only just recently come across it, and I might be getting this wrong, but this is smaller, right, than the distances, and this is between the hydrogen atoms. It's not like the distance here, the bond length. This is the distance. It says here are four H atoms at distances of 1.23 to 1.36 angstroms, right? So there's four of them with a pop, because it's like a warped LiAlH6. No, that's a Li3AlH6. It's kind of like in a warped state. And that warped state gives four of them very, very close proximity. And this distance here is even shorter than it is for germanium. So, if you were to smack this system, yeah, shockwave, could this happen? Well, more likely if it was a, you know, more solid state system, and maybe this allows it to be slightly more solid state, yeah, because you shock propagation. I don't know. But what I'm saying right down the bottom here is, could the kinetic impacts from that the quadrium, which decays into the four helium with incredible energy release, could that in itself cause shock waves that go locally through the material surrounding the event that occurs and stimulates the effect further? Yeah? There's ammonia. It's got really short lengths, but I think there's too much chemistry there, but that's just by the by. So, that's basically the sum of everything I wanted to say on this. These are some other experiments which we want to conduct to try and give evidence to or for or against various proponents like Pintelli and Stoyan-Sarg and Brillouin, try and get some understanding. I won't go into these because you've seen the meat of this presentation. So thank you for watching. I hope that maybe there is someone out there with the wherewithal to stream one of these experiments during ICCF 20. I think there is a number of specific experiments, particularly the meltdown and the one that, well, the meltdown you can potentially do live. You need to be really good about your safety and understanding what's going on there. Remotely operated lab, and preferably, and almost certainly, you would want neutron detectors just in play to observe, okay? Play really safe. We've seen high energy, what looks like the result of extremely high energy beta in the signal. The signal maybe came, and what we saw in 2013 maybe come from the residual deuterions that are in natural gas or natural lithium, natural hydrogen gas or natural lithium aluminium hydride, yeah? And then the one about 6-lithium. If you're okay, you're in an institution that's able to look for 6-lithium, you can do the experiment that does not include any 6-lithium. And it would be really great for someone, you know, maybe Alan Goldwater with his excellent glow stick design could do an experiment which did not include any lithium. And so if we see lithium in the ash, boom, it's done. Thank you for watching. Please, if you are able to help us in any way by spreading this message, by being really seriously critical about what I've said and pointing that to references, those criticisms and supporting those with references, or if you feel that you would like to see some of these experiments done, it would be great if you know someone that's able to contribute either in equipment terms, human resources, lab space, or money so that we can settle this, because it's tiresome with all the variations. We want to end this debate. Thank you for watching.